Hello and welcome to Last on the Brakes. Lockdown Last on the Brakes, I should say. This week's episode is with Maverick Viñales, MotoGP star, potential championship candidate, and we have him for a full, fat and cream 30-35 minutes for your ears. Fran, what do we talk about with Maverick on the show today? How about that for an intro?
Really wondered where that was going. that was great. Top stuff. So with Top Gun, we have, I think, a good delve behind the scenes. We all know the results. We've all seen the races. We've not all had a good, nice chunk of time to sit down and really ask, okay, so what's that like? Or why did this happen? Or how did you feel at this time? How is it dealing with pressure or hype or any of these different things? So we hope you enjoy it. I think it's a good little dive behind the scenes. And as always, of course, we have the Kenwood Quickfire at the end.
Quite. Really sort of cutting through the murkiness of what you can normally get through PR speak, I suppose, in on race weekends. Getting to the bottom of how Maverick's really feeling on those weekends.
Of course, exactly our aim with these podcasts. Just get a little bit deeper behind and, have a good chat with a very relaxed rider at the moment is Maverick.
Bless him.
So I hope you enjoy it. Like you said, quick fire at the end. What's Top Gun's real favourite film and more will be revealed. So thanks to our sponsor, Kenwood, MotoGP radio provider and the sponsor of this podcast for making this all possible. And without further ado, we hope you enjoy it.
As you know, this is a podcast, so it's just like a general chat rather than just like Q&A sort of thing. So we've got a range of things that we want to ask you, basically. So we'll crack on, shall we? First of all, want to know how is lockdown for you? Because you've been so active doing all these interviews, doing workouts, so active on social media and everything. Do we need to worry about you? Have you been lonely or something? Or have you just been enjoying it?
I enjoy quite a lot because for me it's very unusual time that I can be at home. Normally, you know, also I was traveling a lot to Doha and then Andorra, so I was always living with all my suitcase, all the luggage everywhere, all the clothes everywhere, so I never had enough time to sit down, to calm a little bit and to organize, you know, my home and everything. So I think has been pretty good to calm down a little bit and think about everything.
That's true. I think it's good when we can find the small positives, even if they are small, is good.
Yeah.
And having a break, when especially as the calendar gets longer and longer, there is definitely something to be said for just calm, relax a little bit. But okay, so we'll go back now. The start of your career, at least in the World Championship.
All right.
2011, you went straight into a full season and you won your fourth ever race, right? Le Mans.
Yes.
So when normally we see guys do a couple of wild cards, maybe you kind of know more what to expect. You went straight in. Did you expect to be so competitive? You won a few races. You were third overall. You really kind of hit your stride early.
Well, I have to say that I didn't make any wild card because I'm from January. So it's before the championship start. So I made a year and then I go straight to the World Championship. And for sure, when I did the first race, I see quite far away to win a race. But in Jerez, I remember it was wet. I was fighting for the podium on wet and broke the bike. And then in Estoril, I don't make the podium by 0.0 something. I fight against Zarco. So we arrived to Le Mans. Was a track that since the first lap, I hit a good lap times, even if I don't know the track. So straight away, I was very fast. And then I qualify in the front row because in the other races, I qualify maybe 7th, 8th. So I was not so good on qualifying yet. But then in Le Mans, I qualify in the front row and I say, okay, this is my chance, you know. And when I had the opportunity, I was having nothing to lose, everything to win. Even if I crash, I was there in the front battling for the race. So I tried it in the last corner and went well. You know, Le Mans always bring me so good memories.
I got to ask you, though, because coming into that time, you had quite a lot of hype around you. There's quite a few of the riders, well, the ones who are now in MotoGP, when they've come into the World Championship for the first time, they have a lot of hype around them. People are like, this is the guy. This is the guy. This is the guy. How was that for you, sort of, as people were starting to build that more hype around you? Did you feel pressure? Did you embrace it? How was that?
I have to say that I enjoy that pressure. I'm that kind of rider that if they start to say the things, I believe in that things, you know, like if they start to push me that I need to win, I will win because I believe a lot in myself and I have a lot of self-confidence. So I like to have that pressure. As I always say to my team, I love when I'm under the pressure, and normally I take out my best performance when I need, you know. For example, everyone this year could see I crash in Montmeló, straight away I win in Assen. Then I crash in Phillip Island and straight away I win in Malaysia. So when there is difficult moment, I always take out my best potential. Now I have to understand how to take out without this moment.
Okay, we're going to ask you about that later, actually, in like a slightly different topic. But so you feel like that's a positive thing. But like, so we've seen like Fabio seem to have a bit of a more difficult time before he went into Moto2 and then had that belief from Speed Up. Do you think just everyone is different in how they cope with it and how it makes them as a rider?
My thinking is that if you have the enough talent, you will arrive. You will win. Finally, it doesn't matter which way you take, you will arrive. You can see Fabio finally in Moto2 win only two races. And I don't know where he was in the championship, quite far away from the top standing. But he jumped in the Yamaha and he showed all his talent, and you can see, you know, and he's very fast rider. But he has been fast since I know him. I think he was 15 years old, that he was going very fast and everyone was talking about him. So you can see when the rider have talent, doesn't matter the situation, he will take everything and at least show to the people what he can do.
Well, have you and him ever spoken about the respective level of hype that you both received at the start of your careers and that pressure? Have you ever chatted with him about that?
Well, no, I never had the enough time to be close to him to spoke about that things. But for sure, we know now we are on a mission. We have now 2 years to try to win the title and to bring Yamaha to the number one. So for us, it will be very nice season. As right now, I think we are on a good level and we have the enough speed to try to challenge Mark.
Yeah, it looks like it's going to be pretty exciting, that definitely. Yeah. So, okay then. So in 2012, again, you consistently super fast. I think that's your season with the most wins, right? 2012.
Yeah, I win. Yeah. I think I win 5 in a row or something like that.
I know
that's pretty good.
Straight in there, challenging for the title. Then it was quite a dramatic end of the year for you with the team and a few issues. But then in 2013, you came back, you won the title, you're super consistent. Is that another example of when that pressure was really on and then you just go, okay, now I'm back?
Yes. Normally, I'm that kind of rider that, as I said, I believe a lot in myself. And I need to follow my own destiny. I follow my own things. I don't follow what the people tell. Or normally I follow my own decisions because it's what I think is the best for myself. But anyway, in that moment, I have to say that, for example, in 2012, if I am right now in this situation, I will do the things very different. But I will do it, you know. So I will go where I needed to go. And actually, I think in that moment, many people was very critic with myself. But I believe in myself. I know what I was able to do. So I get there and I prove it.
So it sounds like you wouldn't regret it then. Maybe you do it differently now, but find like that's who you are and that's what you chose.
Exactly. I will not regret, honestly, because finally, I think that decision changed many things in my life right now.
Interesting. And then, because it seems like, well, you said there that what people say doesn't really hinder you very much. But when they're saying the positive things, like this is the man, that kind of spurs you on. Has there ever been a time where you felt that maybe an article in the media or someone has said something to you in a press conference has really ticked you off? And has it made you question things or doubt things before?
Well, for sure, I try to take also the negative points, trying to make it on a positive way. For example, if I see that many people are spoken like this, it's because maybe I'm doing something wrong, so I need to improve, you know. But honestly, I don't feel in any moment I get very pissed off about nothing, honestly, because normally, you know, I'm quite easy. I have good relationship with all the media, which is always important. And for sure, it has been, for example, in Yamaha, very tough moments, because everyone was like, these guys need to win. You know, you are in Yamaha, factory team, should be a good bike, but we cannot achieve the results we are able to do. So has been difficult, but I think everyone has taken a lot of care of ourselves, and that was really nice from the media.
Yeah, and of course, a lot of things have changed in MotoGP as well since Yamaha was, I don't think I even need to say arguably, since the Yamaha was definitely the best bike a few years ago. There have been a lot of changes, and obviously that will cause differences up and down pit lane. Do you think it's natural that every now and then there'll be this difference for a few different bikes?
Sure, it is very natural to have bad moments, because you cannot stay always on the top. I mean, it is up and down always in life. But I think I have a lot of trust in Yamaha. That's why I signed 2 more years with them, because I trust in the project. I trust in the people that is there. And for me, Yamaha show a lot of things when they go out and explain really what was happening on the team and on the bike and everything, because finally we had a lot of pressure all the time. And we didn't know how to react, because some races we could win it, some others we were 10th. So my argument at the end, it was difficult, because I don't know what to say, you know. Mm-hmm. And I think from Yamaha was very clever to do that and take out a lot of pressure from the riders. And then I think last year we make an incredible improvement. And I had the chance to build my own team, which I'm super excited for this year, and you know that's the reason why I stay in Yamaha.
What's your mind thinking now? We have got some other questions which I want to go back to, but I want to ask in response to that, how did it feel having all this preseason, being ready, feeling you've made this improvement, you've got this team around you, and then no, Maverick, you're not going racing?
in the first moment, I take it very bad, because I felt so ready. Also physically, I think it was my best moment in the 10 years I'm in the World Championship. So I take it like, no, I cannot believe. But then I take it in another way. I say, okay, I have more time to work also mentally, more time to think about myself, and more time to understand what I need. Because for sure, you know, all the time, our life is all the time running. Here, there, racing. So we never had enough time to sit down and say, okay, now we have to calm down. Mm-hmm. To take out all the emotions. So for me, it's been good. For me, it's been a setup this period right now.
That's interesting, because I think a lot of people focused on, oh, this gives Marquez so much more time to recover from his shoulder. But it is obviously true, but there's time that other riders can use as well. Like, you all know what you want to work on. I guess everyone has something they can use this time to invest in.
Exactly. And finally, the situation, you can take it on a bad way, or you can take all the profit from them. And I think our desire to win is so high that we take this situation to improve, to be better. We are every 4 days in contact with all the team, trying to bring new ideas for the bike and also for myself to be better as a rider, and with the team to be stronger. So yeah, we are taking this time to improve and to be better.
Okay, I want to roll it back a little, because we've done a couple of podcasts recently. We did a podcast last week with Kevin Schwantz, and this week's podcast is with Max Biaggi. And so we asked Max about how he was a four-time 250cc world champion, and does he think that riders move up classes too much these days? Now, you're obviously, in your case, you did the 1 year in Moto2 before moving up to Suzuki. So what, you know, how does a rider decide that when is the right time for them to move up? What was the process in your case?
For me, it was take it or you don't know what's going to happen. Because the problem was that, you know, when everyone signed the contract, I was in Moto2. So I needed to wait 2 more years. 3 years in Moto2 for me was useful. So when David Brivio came to us and said, look, Maverick, we can do this project, we can improve, we can work on it, I say, okay, David, I'm in. Because I see a lot of opportunity. And also, honestly, give me a lot of experience the first year in Suzuki, because for sure the bike was not at the maximum, but I was doing good results. And then the second year was fantastic. So for me, it was the correct decision to move on.
That's cool. Pretty much the same as Juan Mir, I guess. Almost exact copy. Yeah, Just take the opportunity.
for me, it's totally like that. Finally, if you have the opportunity in MotoGP, you have to take, because it's maybe 7 or 8 perfect bikes, and then you don't know what can happen. So if you have one of those bikes, you have to take it.
That's cool. So like you said, in 2015, you were a rookie, and it definitely wasn't a tough year. Results still pretty impressive. Yeah. But how do you change your mentality from winning multiple races every single year to then, okay, today maybe 11th is good?
it was not easy to eat all this, but when I signed the contract, I knew it. So it was my decision. I needed to deal with all of that. For sure, it was not easy because my mentality is a winning mentality. But made me very strong, because made me be calm when I needed to be calm. And honestly, every situation now I'm looking back and I say, okay, what I'm feeling right now is what I learned from the past. Mm.
As in right now with like the patience and that sort of thing with the situation.
And also many things that I needed to develop in Suzuki, you know, to develop one bike, to understand what is better for the race, or I don't know. In Suzuki, I needed to be so good in so many areas to be competitive that I understand many, many things. For example, all the electronics, I understand that the first year very fast, you know, and how to work with that, because I needed to do it. So it was my, let's say, my key to make something more.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. And in 2016, when you were back on the top step at Silverstone, I mean, that was like an amazing race. I'm not sure how many people quite predicted it. But just to go from sort of where you were to just shot off into the distance, goodbye Maverick.
Yeah, literally just
I think in this race I take out all the potential from myself, from the bike, and I think also the combination from the bike and the track was fantastic. I think for many races we were good, but I could not show up the potential because we make many mistakes, or the tire choice, or whatever. But I was coming from many races like, okay, most of the practice I'm top 3, you know? So I knew that moment was going on. And for me, it was a shame that rain in Assen, because Assen, I was very strong. And I thought this weekend I could win like in Silverstone.
Okay, so when it starts to come together again, then obviously you took that win, pretty milestone for Suzuki. You took 2 more podiums, I think, right? 2 or 3?
I think it was four podiums or 5 podiums. I don't remember.
In that year, yeah. So it was a really good year. And then obviously you decided to move to Yamaha. How does that change your mentality again? Because like you already said, Yamaha is sort of expected to win. You've got that one win. You're going up and up and up, showing more and more potential. How does it change your approach when it's like, okay, well, now you have to. You have to at least get on the podium.
For me, it was perfect. I mean, it's what I was looking for. When I'm racing, I'm looking forward to win and to especially to battle the title. So when I move up to Yamaha already from the first day, I say, okay, now I have the chance to fight for the title. So we have to do it. And we show, in the first 6 races, I was leading by 36 points or 40 or more. But then the thing changed and everything started to change. What we did wrong is that we start to change a lot the bike, you know, and then we get so lost. And imagine we get lost 2 years. So it was complicated. I mean, was not easy for myself because imagine I dominate the first races like I wanted. You know, like, okay, now I push, now I stop. Now I push, now I stop. I take the gap. What I do? You know, I was playing a lot with everything and everything goes well. So it was like the bike and myself, we were one. And then they changed the tire. And as soon as the problem was Montmeló, because in Montmeló, we make a mistake with the tire choice and we finish on the back. And after that, Yamaha start to change everything. So I remember in Assen, we take like 3 chassis in the same weekend. I was getting crazy. I get crazy. And I lost completely the feeling with the bike and also a little bit the feeling with the team. So it was very, very hard for myself to understand and also to say, okay, the things are like that. When I was seeing myself champion, you know, and that was pretty difficult for me. I passed difficult times on 17 and 18 because that was not my place, you know, what I was doing. I always thought I was able to do much more. And still I think, you know, like last year, for sure my potential is, we didn't show it yet. So for me it was very important all the development that Yamaha is doing and especially the trust they are giving to me right now.
It's in what you were saying about how, like at Montmeló, you got a bit crazy, you know, there's so many things to juggle.
Yeah.
You lost a little bit of the focus almost, but throughout your career, you'd always been so focused, like, I'm the one, I'm very self-confident, but then you lost it. You know, who was around you that time that you could, did you feel you had anybody to turn to talk to them and to try and help you through it, or was it something you just had to do yourself?
I'm that kind of person that is difficult to help. Because I close a lot to myself and it's difficult that I open my feelings to someone. So I make by myself. I work hard. For sure, I passed some months that I was very upset. And for sure, I needed to, you know, to take out all the emotions. But, you know, then I take it like, okay, if this practice I can be in top 3, it will be perfect. You know, little objective that makes me stay happy and especially makes me stay motivated to keep going, you know, because if you give up then on that moment, then logically Yamaha will choose another rider.
Mm-hmm.
So when did you start to feel that sort of turnaround? Was it when you won in Phillip Island and you broke the Yamaha kind of, I think it was the longest streak without a Premier Class win, or has it been a little bit longer for it to be more consistently back at the top?
A little bit longer. I think in 2019, when I win again in Assen. After that win, then I think my weight in Yamaha changed a lot because no one expect that win, and especially for Yamaha, They struggle a lot. So I think for all the new technicians that were in Yamaha in 2019 was a release of pressure. And I think this gave me a lot of weight inside Yamaha and especially with the new technicians.
Okay, that's really good. And
that's cool.
So I want to change to another topic, like about how you have sort of become so zen, almost so sort of like chill, calm, and everything in all that you do. Because and like you said at the beginning, that race, and like your attitude after what happened in Australia was quite surprising. Actually, like I remember seeing you after the race, and everyone was packing up, and a couple of fans went up to you, and this Aussie fan went up to you and was like, oh, I was so sad you didn't beat Mark. And you're like, oh, it's okay, next time. Whereas some other riders would be so peeved at that. But you weren't. Can you talk us through sort of how you came to that decision that you took positives from that?
You know, I feel I gave the maximum on that race. Mm. So I regret nothing. I would regret if I didn't try that overtake. You know, if I finish the race second without trying the overtake, I will regret a lot. But, you know, I try my best. I tried to pull away in many parts of the track. I had not the chance, so I play all my cards. So all the team knew that was difficult that race because we lost a lot of kilometers per hour on the straight. So we were obligated to make only one attack in that corner. And went like that, we could not do nothing more. also all the team, when I arrived to the box, they were very happy because they knew I tried it. And that's what we were looking forward, you know. And I think in that race, Mark and myself make a so big difference to anyone.
Yeah.
That was a 1-to-1, and that was nice. Honestly, that race means a lot for myself and also for Yamaha, because they know that I fight until the last corner.
I think I saw you said somewhere as well that you almost felt like it had gone right, because you'd planned it in your head so much, and you could see yourself making the move.
Yeah.
You knew what you had to do, so it's like, well, what?
I do it, you know. I just chipped down, leave the brake, and, you know, but finally I lost the rear because I chipped down too fast and with a lot of banking, because we were very fast both, because we wanted to close the door, but I wanted to go in. So, honestly, if I don't crash, I don't know if I finish the corner, I have to say.
Wow. I want to also ask about that sort of calmness state. I watched your interview, which you did with Matt Burt and Valentino the other day, and you said how you're one of those riders who, if you were asked to recall some what you do on the track, and sometimes some overtakes you make, you can't remember it. Talk us a bit through more about that. Does that mean you just get into like this state, this complete zone where you're just completely focused on the present, that you don't register it for the future?
Honestly, like when I finished Malaysia, I said, which lap time I do? My best lap time, you know? I don't even remember. Or for example, like that in the first corner, in the second corner, I overtake Franco, you know? So I don't know. When I get into that concentration, I forget things. I don't know why. I don't know if because I'm really concentrated on the things I'm doing right now. But I forget some parts of the race.
Amazing.
Okay, that's interesting. And also, I guess then, we were going to ask you about bouncing back from that Australia crash to Malaysia. But you've already said, for you, it's like that pressure is what makes you thrive. Do you think Malaysia last year is the kind of potential that you have now, assuming we all get racing again fairly soon?
Well, I have to say that after maybe it was the first time that I crashed in a race and I was happy. Maybe, I think, it's the first time. I have to say that also was a mistake, because if we finished second, we were securing the third place in the championship, you know? And also the first Yamaha in the championship.
Oh, man.
But anyway, I was happy because I say, okay, I give all I get in this race, and that was the most important. And also, what a perfect weekend for us. And I didn't want it to be sad. I want to be, you know, happy, and we bring all the positiveness to Malaysia. And straight away in FP1, when I start in Malaysia, I see my potential and I say, okay, this race I have to start first and go. Yeah. You know, because in Australia I make the mistake. I was maybe seventh in the first lap. So I took a lot of time to take the lead and push. I think in Australia, if I take the lead in the first lap, I was able to pull a gap, because when I arrived to the first place, the tire already was down. And then in Malaysia, I said, man, you have to take the lead and go. So no excuses, just go. And all the weekend was perfect. We work a lot with the team. And the good thing is that everyone was happy. And the atmosphere that is right now inside the team is totally different than a few months ago. So I think the team has been improving a lot and helped me a lot to take out the potential, because I feel very confident.
It sounds like that you are feeling so much happier in general. I hope you won't mind me saying, but during like 2017, 2018, sometimes there would have been some times where you would have told the media, yeah, I'm really happy with everything. And you might have been telling a bit of a white lie. But it sounds like now, whenever you tell someone you are genuinely happy with how things are going, that's going to be the case.
Yeah. Sometimes I needed to lie in 2018. But because I didn't know what to say, because a few times I felt lost. But also was my mistake, because as I said, I close to myself and I'm difficult to open and to show my emotions. Mm. But, you know, now we create that kind of feeling that I can open myself to the team, and I can be one with my team, and we share all the emotions. And it's something we improve quite a lot, and something I really like. And also, as you said, right now I feel so happy. I don't know why, but since 5 months ago, or a little bit more, after the summer break of last year, I feel happy for everything, and it's a really cool feeling.
Happy to hear that. That's, okay. You know, yeah, that's it's a good. Nice thing to hear a rider saying they're genuinely happy with their life and how things are going.
Yeah, like before, always was like, oh man, I want to rest 1 week, and now I have to go racing, blah blah. Now, I would race every day, you know.
Amazing.
I hope maybe soon we can, or maybe we'll have to.
I really wish, because I can't wait to be on the bike and to push. I enjoy to push the bike, and I hope I can do.
Just be careful when you first get on a motocross bike again. When the lockdown is lifted.
No, no problem.
Right?
I will be calm. I will be calm.
Are you sure?
Yeah, I will be calm. Yeah.
All right.
Right, okay, so I think that's all of our main interview questions, but we also have a segment that we do at the end that's little quickfire things.
Let's go.
So it's for our sponsor, Kenwood. They sponsor this segment. They also do MotoGP radios, so we've got to do a good job. So they're easy questions, just like off the top of your head, quick answer.
All right.
Some of them may be a little bit longer. Don't worry if you say more than just like a few words, okay? So, okay. Matt, do you want to start?
Yes, I shall. What do you prefer, coffee or tea?
Coffee.
Schwantz or Rainy?
You put me in a trouble right now, eh? But Schwantz.
Do you prefer a beach holiday or a mountain holiday?
Beach holiday.
If you could choose any rider in history as a teammate, who would you choose?
Valentino. And I have fantastic.
And I know that's not just diplomatic. You genuinely feel that, don't you?
No, I really like. I really like, because he has been my idol since I'm a kid.
Okay. Dogs or cats?
Dogs.
What's the best corner on the calendar?
Last corner of Phillip Island.
Awesome. Getting up early or staying in bed?
Getting up early normally, but Sundays I like to stay on the bed.
All day?
Most of the day. looking the computer or doing just relaxed stuff.
Just chill time.
Yes.
So which actor would you choose to play you in a movie of your life?
Jason Statham.
Jason Statham.
Okay, really?
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah, you know that one that make the last Fast and Furious movie. You know which one? Eh?
Yeah.
Wow, so, I love how he do all the actions, and he's strong man.
Jason Statham, that's such a classic British actor.
That's such a British choice. Yeah, thank you.
I like a lot the movies. I have seen all the movies he does.
Awesome. Okay, one place that you haven't been that you would like to visit?
Right now, Russia. I never been there, and I would like to visit.
Nice.
Cool. And then this one might be related to that question a minute ago. Your favorite film?
Wow, I have to say, and someone will kill me if I don't say, Top Gun. And Transporter is always I like a lot. Fast and Furious.
You like action movies then? Yeah, plenty of
adrenaline. Well, but I also like fantasy movies like Harry Potter, Lord of the Ring, so I'm quite easy. If the movie is good, I stay watching them.
I've got to ask you, have you ever spoken to Tom Cruise or been in contact? Has he sent a message?
I really would like. We were spoken to make the announcement of the Top Gun, the second movie of the Top Gun here for Spain. But I think, as Tom Cruise, he was riding the Kawasaki, I was not able to do it because they wanted to do it with Kawasaki. So
that's got
to
be sorted.
It's a problem, isn't it? Someday it has to happen because he loves this stuff as well, doesn't he? He's like speed and action and...
Okay.
I hope...
Well, last one.
I challenge him.
You challenge him. Okay, we're going to take this clip. We're going to take this clip and have you challenging him out somewhere.
Okay.
So, last question then. What's your favorite win?
My favorite win so far, it's Malaysia 2019. But the most important one has been Silverstone 2016.
Nice. Two different answers. Excellent.
I like that.
Well, that's it for the Kenwood Quickfire and your questions. Okay. I really, really appreciate your time.
Thank you.
And I do like the photos you've got behind you then, just because given that
I have like every year photo. Like we have 17, 18, 19, and I have the podiums and the victories.
Mm.
So it's a book that Yamaha is doing for all the member staff.
Oh.
And it's fantastic. Now I want that all my mechanics, they can sign this book. So
oh,
I will
that's cool.
The track.
Oh, that's really nice. Excellent. What a lovely bit of motivation there as well, I guess.
Thank you.
Awesome. Okay, well, we'll let you go, shall we?
All right.
So thank you very much for joining us. And, well, and hopefully we get to see you back out on a bike fairly soon.
Soon.
Yeah.
Let's see. It's been too long. All right. Well, in that case, we'll see you soon.
Yeah,
thank you so much.
Talk to you soon. Bye.
Thank you, guys.
Stay safe. Don't get too bored of the interviews as well.
Yeah.
Bye.
Bye. So thank you very much for joining us once again for another lockdown edition of Last on the Breaks. Hope you enjoyed that. And we'll be back, as ever, with more next week. And with another exciting guest, I can't tell you who just yet. So we can't. But it will be high profile, interesting, everything you've come to expect from us, hopefully. So thanks for joining us once again. If you do have any comments, questions, suggestions, anything you want to know, get in touch with us with the hashtag MotoGP Podcast, and we will do our best to have a look through those. And I think that's everything. Not much to debrief
like
on this one.
Like and subscribe
one.
On YouTube if you're watching on there, which I hope you do, and get a bit of visual Viñales. Visual Briggs, Visual Viñales, although you'll have just had, of course, Visual Schwantz as well.
Oh.
So Visual Viñales works a lot better, doesn't it, really? We should probably go before I say anything more stupid.
It does. I'm shocked we didn't use that for the entirety of the episode. So,
don't want to offend the man.
Many thanks for joining us, and we'll see you again soon, and ciao.
Bye.
For now.